My name is Ryan Sallows. I'm the business manager at Ori High School, and my colleague, co-presenting with me today, is Helen Everitt. She's a deputy head teacher, one of the deputy head teachers here, and Helen assumed the responsibility 2 years ago for Pupil from another colleague, so we work very closely on the agenda, and Helen's really picked up and running it. And today we're just going to talk to you about our experience with Pupil Premium and what we've done. I'm not going to call out, you can see it's fairly clear. And Helen and I were last night just talking around what we were going to get from the session. And I think the thing we're going to finish on really is the bottom bullet point. It's how we really need to identify how some of our whole school improvement approaches to lots of things across the school can be influenced by what we've done with this cohort of children. I think it's fair to say this cohort of children in our school were proved to be a very interesting cohort of students for us as we sort of looked more closely at them and what they were and were not doing in our school. It's a fairly well-known agenda now. This is something we did for governors a couple of years ago, a very quick slide. Educational inequality was tackled. As a business manager, I do like the second one. Allocate schools in addition to their budget. It is in addition to our budget because it's all separate, but we could have a long discussion now about where other bits of money disappear from our budget, but we do have it. It's quite distinct. We allocate it separately in our funding, so we don't lose sight of it. It's there. And it is funded to technical disadvantage and reaches students that need it most. And that's something we very much focused on, getting this money, this resource, into the students that need it most. I think we'll all agree with the last bullet point. That is true, and we try to relay that message as well to these students in some of the approaches we've done. The first bullet point, we do break it down by socioeconomic group now because the Pupil Premium money of FSM we always knew about, but Pupil Premium, the FSM, ever 6 students, that are students that the colleagues might not know. The government decided that ever 6 students were students who had been registered on the free school meals list in the last 6 years. So they could have been on it for one term in year 5, and they were still counted in our funding and thus our statistics when they were in year 10. But then we had to watch the ever 6 list because some children drew in their life memorial, but 1 year beyond our Pupil Premium cohort, by year 10 were off of it because their family hadn't registered again. So it's a bit of a small moving cohort, and you have to keep a track of those children. And the second bullet point there, it always strikes us in secondary school, but if by the age of 7, which is year 3, is it 2, 3, they're having low attainment, they don't reach the expected level 1, level 4 by the end of PE stage 2, and that sets a precedent. As we all know in secondary, those children join us or have got below literacy and numeracy levels at level 4 at the moment. Are a big focus for us and to keep them maintained through in secondary school to perform and unable to pass or get good grades at GCSE or make progress is a challenge. And again, when we look at the cohort, a lot of these children, our Pupil Premium children, were the ones that are coming with lower academic levels. This is a nice Ofsted graph that we found, and it's very interesting actually because the dotted line just shows when the Pupil Premium was introduced, just around 2011-12. But if you look, and I did this morning very quickly, at the difference between non-FSM, this is FSM only, and FSM children attainment-wise from 2005 all the way to 2011, it actually hasn't narrowed. It remains about the same, so 28% gap, and all the way up to 27 at the end. So even though the attainment of other non-FSM has gone up and the attainment of the gap nationally has stayed the same. Now, Pupil Premium funding, it will probably take a few years for it to see any impact nationally. But very interestingly, despite the results in the early years, it hasn't really closed that gap. So we're sort of conscious of that for the national picture. And that influenced quite a bit of our thinking as we the strategy for it. Helen and I Sallows have embarked on quite a few conferences, trekking around the country a couple of years ago, and the chap always talks about Pupil Premiums, Sir John Dunford, the National Pupil Premium Champion. Once you've seen one of his presentations, it's pretty much, you see them all in a way. But one chart that struck us was this chart about the percentage of say four people eligible for the Pupil Premium and what their attainment was. And if you had a smaller cohort, and it looks at 3%, you got better outcomes. If you went down the curve, and when we looked, we are in this cohort here. So we've got 10 to 13% of our students are Pupil Premium, and nationally, we are making, as a school group, we'd be in a group making less progress through those students. So that struck us, and we were thinking, we're actually in a group of students. Also, we're in a leafy suburbia around the Shire counties. You know, another group of schools which is deemed by Ofsted and the DoD not to do so well with these children. So we're up against it, we thought, at that point, a couple of years ago, we thought we were in the group of schools that perform less well and make less progress with these students. And many made us quite determined to buck that trend. We go, we don't want to be in this. We are in this group consistently presented, but we want to be further up of the scale and see if we can make some real progress. So it's quite a motivating slide for us. But it is interesting, if your school has got less or maybe more, you tend to do better. We went to a few conferences where a few people talked to us from different schools in large urban areas, Leeds, Birmingham, where there was 80% of their children were Pupil Premium. It's a different ballgame altogether, most of your cohort are Pupil Premium, and they've got some very good attainment levels for them. Some London schools, and it made us feel bad about ourselves. But we also went in for knowing how things taste. In a council like West Sussex, the percentage of Pupil Premium students we've got, we're pointed out on the stat, that's the attainment we're getting, and we can do better. West Sussex is an interesting local authority. It wasn't particularly praised for its progress as a LA for Pupil Premium students, either, because the schools it has in the county. But they were just around the national average for children achieving 5A stars to C. But 34% of their FSM children achieved this, and their national average was 41%. So they were sort of in the lower of the four local authorities. So then we thought, well, we're in the lowest performing group of schools with essential kids. We're in a local authority area that doesn't do particularly well either for these children. We've got some work to do. And again, our children who are looked after, we don't have a lot of looked after children in the school here. We've had two or three, they're no individuals that come well known to us, and generally done quite well. Some of our pupils, not quite as high as 45%, but have SEM as well, or low ability. So we sort of thought, can we do better than West Sussex? Or we think we can. The funding, this national picture, it shows you the emphasis the government put on it during the last parliament, the coalition government, because it was pretty much a Liberal Democrat, so they pushed for it, really. And it's grown, and it's probably one of the only areas of school funding that has significantly grown over time. And what that means in our context is we currently have 13%, 149 students across the years, 7 to 11 on the roll. That would be a growing fund, £30,000 in 2011-12. £30,000 in the budget is not a great deal of money in a secondary budget. I know you look at it and think, okay, breakfast, and we have a good chat, and we walked off, and I said, right, we've got to make a look for the account for it, and a couple of colleagues walked off. And we saw for that first year, if I'm being honest, did what we always did. We didn't change anything, we just had these kids in different sets across the school, and we sort of said, we'll do some intervention with them. And then we realised at the end of the year, we didn't really do any intervention with them, they weren't in intervention groups, but it didn't matter, and we just weren't aware of them, and it wasn't a fix of some of the money. It grew in 2012-13 to 75,000, and grew again in 13-14, and then more emphasis was given to it. DfE, David Laws, people, Ofsted, more emphasis on this. And then after the first year, probably after 11-12, in the year 2012-13, I think it's when we really started to develop our own cohort of children. And really have a bit of a fright about what was not happening, maybe more in terms of outcomes. It's been a growing fund, except rare, very rare, but we've kept it very separate. And there was lots of in 2012, when we first got the money, the guidance had come with it said, if you haven't got an attainment gap between your non-FSM or non-fuel premium and your fuel premium, you can use the money for what you like. Which is why some people went off and bought IT with it, because I don't think we haven't got a problem. But we did, so we kept it separate. Our standards, the 11-12, made us a bit uneasy and a bit sad, because it's not the way in which we thought for our children, and it's not what we thought they were achieving, and it's not what the ambitions we had for them. For the school, I'm a business owner, and I'm sort of saying, this isn't, but it doesn't feel very good. They're obviously quite happy, our students, and we're not really doing what we should be doing. 30% of our fuel premium cohort, 5A starter seats, against an average 39%, we were below everything. Progress in English, way behind progress in maths, 29% is not good. So we had some work to do. About a year into the money, a year into the programme, Ofsted started to produce more documentation, and I don't like to make Ofsted talk to them as a business manager, but we have to be aware they do provide us with some good information and some useful documents, particularly around fuel premium. And they had a document, and it was probably 2012-13, about successful approaches that they'd noticed from some of their inspections in schools. And we used it, Helen and I sat down and used it and said, where are we at with this? And this is where we're at, and we ran for it last night. There's only one green one on it, funding. We stuck it in a separate pot in the budget. I said, there's the 30,000, there's the 75,000, that's fuel premium money. And that was about it. We weren't doing anything else, and we had to change our approach rapidly. We didn't have high expectations of this target group, as you can see from the previous stats. They weren't achieving, they weren't actually attending. They were our worst attenders, worst attainers, worst progress, weren't getting credits or rewards, for no apparent reason, because there is nothing linking these children apart from socioeconomic circumstances. These children are disparate, some of them are more able, some of them are less able. They are a random group, and yet as a group, they hit every port of it we could have. So we weren't doing any of these things. We didn't analyse which pupils were underachieving, why. We didn't use any evidence to get funding. We did have high quality teaching in the paint and interventions. We did have highly trained support staff, but we weren't using them for this group of children. And we sort of had a senior leader. I was sort of dynamic, it's sort of me, and I'm a crook, and I didn't think I counted really in terms of making an impact with these children. But this one struck us most. Our staff didn't know who these kids were. We've never identified them. We don't know who they are. We can't do anything with them. And we didn't have any impact. So we felt, again, we were being honest with ourselves. We weren't in a great place to do it. Pass that to Helen. We've got some other.
What was the water look like? I'm keen as well as we go through this, there's been quite a small number, to kind of get a bit of feedback from you guys and kind of how you feel about this agenda. Because I think the first thing we did when I kind of took over this, it was really important that the senior leader was making sure that every single point we were talking about these students. Because actually, to start with, it was a bit of a controversial agenda. There were people, even at SLT meetings, sat around the table saying, but is this right? Is this right that this group of children, simply linked by an economic disadvantage factor, should be attracting this sum of money? Is it right?
Yeah, in short.
Because there were people who were saying, well, why not, if somebody hasn't applied for free school meals and therefore doesn't appear on the, is it right that it should be so ring-fenced and we should be just looking at impact around these students? And I would argue, yes, absolutely, it is right. Because, like Ryan said, on every single measure, when we sat down and looked at our own students, they weren't getting as many credits, they were getting more detentions, they weren't attending extracurricular clubs, they were behind their targets, their parents weren't coming into parents' evening. On every single measure you could think, this disparate group of students in our school were underachieving. And so I think it is right. Our strategy, and I'm lucky we've got two deputy pastoral leaders or deputy heads of community here with us this morning, but our strategy was very, very simple. We as a school, our pastoral system is very, very strong. We know our students. We've got a perfect setup in terms of four learning communities with a pastoral structure who are very, very strong at knowing what our students are like, what makes them tick, what makes them do well, what the issues are with those students. And that really is at the heart of our people premium strategy. It's all about identifying the needs of those individual students, and it's all about recognising not people premium as a cohort, but our people premium students as 149, that's how many we've got at the moment, 149 individuals. So, kind of Team PP was created, a task force of people who are going to build on work that had already been done and really champion these students and get to the heart of what the issues were. So in terms of our learning community structure here at Zenbury Oriel, we have a head of community and a deputy head of community and a pastoral coordinator. It was the deputy pastoral leaders, the deputy heads of community, who were charged with getting to know the students. And it was a big job to start with because we hadn't at that point interviewed them all, but that was what we then set about doing. We still, as team of people premium, we meet once a week and we have a breakfast meeting with bacon buddies once a week to talk through kind of arising issues and get to grips with collaborating about what might work for one student, might work for another student, and sharing ideas. So that's what we did. And our deputy pastoral leaders have met with all people premium students. At the end, there's a range of documents that I've printed out if people are interested and want to take them away that show some of the documentation we've kind of used with our people premium students. One of those things being a simple pro forma that's filled in after one of these interviews. But it was all just getting the students to talk about themselves, talk about what's going well, talk about what they might be worried about, identifying perhaps what subjects they enjoy most, what subjects they don't enjoy, getting them to think about how the school can support them. It covered things like IT access, it covered things about where do you do your homework, so that we could start on a student-by-student basis to say, okay, this student's having issues with this element of their school life, what can we do to support them? So it's about this whole idea of identifying barriers that are stopping them perhaps doing as well as they could do. And when all those forms come in, we're able then to kind of triangulate and look at, okay, well, we've got this batch of students in year eight who have all got this same issue. Okay, what can we do to support them? Right at the beginning, Ryan wrote a letter which went home to every parent of people premium students, which was very upfront, very honest about this is the money, it's coming in, you are part of this cohort simply because at some point in the last 6 years you have applied and received free school meals. But as well, it was very upfront about, you know, talk to us. If you've got an idea of something that we could be doing in school that you think would benefit your son or daughter, you know, do contact us, come in, we have drop-in sessions, come in and suggest some ideas that might support. So it's not rocket science. The strategy is simply identification of barriers and then coming up with possible interventions that might work. And at this point, you're going to have to have a bit of thinking time. What I've done is you have got, and we'll spend, I don't know, 6 or 7 minutes and talk to somebody sat next to you, I think. If you want to jot ideas down, please do. We've got two made-up students. They could be two students that just had their interview with their deputy pastoral leader. There's a little bit of context about, there's one on the back and one on the front. They've just had their interview maybe with their pastoral deputy pastoral leader, and this information's come back. What would you, at this point, identify as being their possible barriers to success? Some of it might be predicting into the future, what could become a problem, and what possible interventions might be put in place. So do talk to each other. Work with somebody sat near you.
It's a bit quiet. It's just this.
One chair. That conversation will be on that tech, by the way. But yeah, it perhaps, maybe you and I will sit and work it out, because with line management changing this year as well, that's another thing that has changed and means we haven't had the same check because there's other changes. You can't. It's a bit of a disc down here when you turn the switch on. So.
Is about that, sitting around the table and unpicking, you know, looking at the child's timetable, who have they got for this subject, who have they got for that, what could be the hidden factor that's making them do better in this subject, and that can we learn from that, can we use that elsewhere? Absolutely. What about Hannah? Any thoughts on Hannah?
We've talked mainly about Hannah,
and
we've got the main thing that was lacking was kind of continuity because of the single parent doing shift work. So maybe not always doing them before and after school, and also catching the bus across town, which means that they're not really part of the
bus across town is a difficult one. What interventions could you put in place in terms of, it says at the end there, attending some punctuality or what?
Taxi.
Yeah.
Same taxis. Well, we've had the issue that those are incredibly expensive and can be quite unsuccessful in getting their jobs. So that's where the dichotomy comes with that. And how do you get in close to the fact that the supply is active and it isn't being moved, which we have on a number of occasions.
Absolutely.
And in many sort of situations, it does work. You know, there are most Catholic schools, 3/4 of their population, bus, taxi, minibus, vehicle, in some way.
Mm-hmm.
So, why is it working? Why is it working for them? And why don't we struggle to get it to work in this situation with disadvantage?
We were also saying that if you are going to do a taxi, you're going to need to do it for the morning only, because if she's then got to leave, that bang on the bell because the taxi's waiting. But actually, that stops those extra trickle things. So, you know, an issue, yeah. Which is the other thing is that it needs to kind of be a morning taxi or a morning method of getting her in. And then her still have kind of independence to go home on the bus when she's had time with friends. And we said, building on from that socialisation stuff, she's not going to be able to have friends back to her house as easily as someone in the local area. And whether maybe what might help is if we know there are families that she's friends with, maybe trying to put mum in touch with another mum and have kind of a social network, because mum doesn't have any friends either. Mum doesn't have someone who says, well, I'll pick her up, I'll pick her tea, don't worry, she can come to our house. Mm-hmm. And actually, I think sometimes we forget that. We forget that adults need that support network as well, but they are far less likely to get it and far less likely to ask for it. I think we need to look at the whole picture.
And parental engagement is something that is going to be a big focus for us. Moving forward.
Being a my nephew, my sister was in the primary school, to be part of a single parents club.
Okay.
So it's like they meet up once a month or something. And so they now all know each other, they've got camp in the morning and stuff. And that's
quite
cool. So they all know the people in the school. But they're not part of the kind of mum and dad crew, like the invitees and stuff.
Yeah.
Middle class mum and dad crew in the school. And they're not part of that. But now they're part of the different.
That kind of thinking outside the box and coming up with new ideas, I think, is what we were all about in that the kind of first year. This is some of the interventions we did in the first year, and some of them to start with, like some transit transport. We thought that was going to be the answer to everything. We kept coming up with this school, okay, then they're not coming in school, you know, taxi, and saying we're going to do that. Ben's absolutely right. Things have to be right in school for that to be able to work. The engagement side of things in school and the student doing well in school really has to be successful before, suddenly by having a taxi turn up the door is miraculously going to make everything better. Because we had a problem of somebody whose attendance was really, really poor, setting up the taxi system, the taxi would turn up and they would still be in bed and they wouldn't get in the taxi and money wasted, etc., etc. So I think we learned a lot from that. One-to-one tuition, you know, all of the education endowment Foundation stuff all says that one-to-one tuition is right up there in terms of what is most successful. Yes, it is expensive, but still that's something that we put a lot of emphasis on in terms of what's working really well for our students. We've gone out and we've recruited our own intervention tutors. There's a room where they work, which we're going to do even more with next year to make it a kind of better environment. And students are nominated for that, and what we're now continuing to build on is kind of the whole monitoring the impact of that one-to-one tuition. We've got a lovely online science tuition set up. We can do other subjects too, where a wonderful tutor sits in Wales, and we have an allotted time, and the students, we can have up to 12 students all together, can log on and have a science revision session led by a real person. They sit with little mini headsets and talk to the tutor talks to them, and that's been really successful. Life coaching, we first came across Olive Pennington, who's our life coach, when she led some big workshops with 60 plus students, which actually was a people premium intervention, and we decided actually after those sessions we weren't quite sure on a student by student basis what the real impact of that was. But Olive, the presenter, was amazing. She engaged with the students, that they responded really well to her, and we at that point started to employ her for 30-minute life coaching sessions with students. Students are nominated and referred for the programme, and they may continue just for a couple of weeks, they may have a 6-week programme, it might go all longer. But it's very different to counselling. It is entirely based around kind of academic progress. Everything comes with an academic target. So students might leave their 30-minute session with a target of, right, I've now got to go and see my English teacher, and I've got to plan how I'm going to now structure this essay because I'm worried about it, and I know I've got to get it in before that time. And Olive will talk through kind of how the students need to structure their own thinking about kind of managing their workload. Some of it is, you know, self-esteem based, but always she'll bring it around full circle and come back to some kind of academic target. Laptops, again, it's easy to say, obviously you haven't got IT here and a laptop, but I think, again, the climate, the way the student is engaging with their schoolwork needs to be right before that really has a good impact. And all the standard kind of things of, you know, making sure that our people bring in students are well prepared going into their exams with all the right equipment, they've got revision guides, and we've got a bank of resources in school that we use for those. Mentoring, to start with, was mainly using our own staff in the building, and something we're now looking to do even more of is using external mentors, and they might be members of the local community, using employers, using ex-students is something we want to do as well, and have a bank of mentors that we can match students up to. I think enrichment too, kind of to start with, it was, okay, Reggie wants to learn to play the drums, okay, we'll play him to learn the drums. And it's a little bit kind of grey in terms of how are we going to really measure the impact of that, which really, impact became our key focus. Now, we have a referral form for all interventions, and again, I've copied some off if you're interested in having a look at what we use. Because the important thing, absolutely everything we do, we have to have an idea of why we're doing it, and how we can measure whether it actually succeeded, how we can measure if it actually made an impact. So the referral form simply says what we're suggesting would be a good intervention for the student, so it might be drum lessons. Where are they at the moment? Why are we suggesting this could be a successful intervention? And how are we going to measure, maybe in, you know, half a term, a term's time, whether it's had an impact? With music lessons, often it would be attendance, because actually, if attendance is poor and then something's put in place that happens on a Tuesday, it becomes a motivator and can get those students to kind of re-engage with school, particularly on those days when they're having their music lessons. Provision Operator is a programme that we bought which simply just helps us log all of this information. Entry points, so I mean, if a student's been put forward for a maths tuition, what's their level at the moment? Recording what interventions are taking place, and then there's a way of having a kind of exit point, evaluating against criteria so we can see on an intervention by intervention basis which things have been successful. Go to schools we use, we monitor attendance, all of those things give us progress updates which we can use to look at impact. Because that's what, and I will use the A word, but that's what Ofsted are after. It's not just how you spent the money, it's whether you spent the money and it's been successful. But I've said this hundreds of times on what we've met here at school. It doesn't matter if sometimes you make a mistake. It really doesn't matter if sometimes you do something and it really doesn't have the impact. Because actually that's a positive thing. You say, okay, we've tried it, it didn't work, we won't do it again. What should we do differently? And that whole idea of it being about research, it being about trying things, and eventually you'll get to a place where you can identify those key interventions that really do work. So kind of moving into this year, we've used people bringing money to employ an intervention coordinator who was an existing member of staff who was working in admin and SIMS, has moved over, and she manages all of these interventions and is doing a fantastic job actually. And we're looking to expand that further next year in terms of her working even closer with the maths department and English department to kind of pull in all intervention that's happening across the school, not just for people bringing all together in one place. And it's kind of a bit more now about structure and systems and rigour and making sure these things like referral forms, measuring impact, plotting entry and exit points, all of that is done so that we've got a real clear picture of what is working and what isn't and whether we're succeeding. Mentoring, developing initiative, finding that person who's going to make a difference to individual students is really key. And lots of students, and you'll see it on the interview form, we ask, would you like a personal mentor? And lots of students who've said, yes, I'd really like somebody who's there to say, have you done your homework, or to kind of be the person that keeps checking in and seeing how I'm doing. Lots of students want that and feel that would be a good thing, and so it's about then matching up who would be a really good mentor to work with that student. That's our data. It's a bit of a mixed picture.
I think folks down in cycles to show, while we talked a bit about where we were at initially with the agenda and the performance and where we moved towards and development, it's not perfect. You know, we've sat conferences before, so fluent about we do this, we do that, and we've done this, and we've run a few premium hall, and aren't we fair? And we've looked at a couple, and they had 12 in year 11, and they managed to get 7 of them, 5 ASRs this year, and that's got 63%. I think that's not quite the same, but actually, we've done a lot of good work, but it still is, still doesn't always look that great statistically, but we still roll with it.
Why must we be suspicious about this? Why shouldn't I be saying I need to be sacked for the fact that that's our biggest gap last year in terms of the 5A start to see, including English and maths?
Because
we're
changing
beta. It's had a bit of an impact, but that's not necessarily what I was thinking, actually.
It's first entry rule, I imagine, it's had a bit of...
Not even that. Nothing to do with rules or regulations. It's the cohort.
Numbers.
Could be numbers. And who those kids are? If this year our pupil premium kids happen to all have targets that were actually not to achieve 5A starts including English maths, well, there's only so much we can do.
It's attainment.
Yeah, this is attainment, this is progress. So actually this, we're super proud. Yeah. And this affects our head of English probably is too. But we're massively close to the gap in terms of English. Maths, lots of work to do. We're roughly in line with national average, but maths is a big focus for us for this year. And Becky's doing some great work in maths too. Parental engagement, I said, is a big challenge and something I want to do lots and lots of work on into next academic year, because I really do think that's the key in terms of just the kind of things we're talking about. What can we do to help parents engage with what we're doing in school? Because time and time again, the people bringing in students whose parents aren't coming to parents evening or haven't logged in to go for schools or aren't using Show My Homework. So there we go with data and kind of en masse, but I think probably what we're most proud of is kind of on a case-by-case, individual basis, some of the success stories of our students. And that's where I want to finish.
And before we get one of the things we did learn on that little talk.
Help me if you can, I'm too
One of the things we learned while we went around the places we sort of looked and thought about ourselves was people saying to us, talk about your successes, and we don't often do that with people group kids or SDM kids or that. And we tried very hard to focus on that. So some of those snippets of kids over the last 2 years of our staff have recognised that done well. But there are still, once we would admit it, there are still children in that focus that sit through our fingers for a net. You know, we didn't quite make that progress. So we missed, you know, we just think, well, they got a D in maths, not a C, and we were surprised. But where did we miss this girl? What happened? So, but predominantly, it's a positive agenda, and we've made some good strides. So, if you're doing your own school, think about the kids that you're supporting, think about the kids that are in that cohort, who are making progress for achieving, and celebrate them, especially internally, and we do with the children, obviously. So, because it makes a big difference as well to how you feel about the agenda, and it encourages us to take more risks and say, let's try this. And the taxi is a great one. You know, I own a business owner, someone comes down and goes, Stephanie didn't get in our taxi this morning, but we just had an invoice for the taxi bill. She did get in five of them. She told the taxi driver she'd been out of school today, went back in and had a dressing gown, went to bed. And you'd walk around and say, but actually, you carry on with it, you think of something else, and not everything works. Our approach would just be just go up, take some risks, and go through it. We couldn't have done any worse than we already 11 as well at this total, so that was that. And that was
any questions?
I don't actually. Can I just start? Yeah, the slide that had sort of the smaller cohorts and bigger cohorts, and we were sat in the middle.
Yes.
Sort of like, how did the bigger cohorts get the kind of the statistics we expected the smallest cohorts? But the bigger cohorts suddenly happened after that?
I think probably if your school and say 90% or 70% of your students are people breathing, it becomes your bread and butter stuff. It becomes what you're doing with everybody. Whereas when you think about us, if we're on 13%, we're doing lots of other stuff with everybody, which is one set of interventions, and then we've got this smaller.
Bigger interventions that actually work across the whole school because
of
the
whole
focus.
I think that's how I'm in that track, isn't it?
Yeah, we are.
If we're not small enough to do one-to-one intervention with 7 or 8 pupils across the school.
Yeah, absolutely.
No.
We've got 40.
And we're not big enough to do whole cohort intervention at 9%, so 10%.
What we found with that as well, that when we started to implement that, initially they didn't want to do it because they didn't want anyone to see that they were getting an intervention. It's only when they had the intervention and they felt that it was working and was making a difference to them that they started really enjoying it and engaging better. But for almost all of them initially they were like, I don't want to try.
Yeah, that's true.
And I think that's because they felt like they were being singled out. And I suppose if two-thirds of the school are all getting the same thing, you're not feeling like you're being singled out, it's just what everyone gets.
But I have sat with, you know, other deputies or heads at conferences, and you know, we've got 90% of their students being approved. It's just a completely different ballgame. It's a different set system.
Which I guess is a dream scenario, because then you can just.
It's just what you do every day. And you probably include the 10% one as well.
Yeah. What we did at like early conferences was people saying, London school, London boroughs, they're brilliant. Look at us hanging. I mean, if you look at the top performing people through local boroughs, most of them are London boroughs. And we can't compete. So we started actually looking at we got some information from the borough council about our social economic profile as a town. And when we looked at like for like towns, our nearest economic, social economic partners as Crawley, so Farnborough was one. Hillingdon in London was our. And we started to look at schools in those areas saying, how are they doing? Because they've got the same sort of kids and families and structures we have. And we were pretty comparable when we started to compare ourselves with like for like rather than go around again. These schools in Barnet and these schools in town and it's turning up the rule of it is and we're floating around. But we were in that, and when we found our shop, we were in that group of schools, we were there. And it was motivating. I have to be honest, personally, a bit impressive. Poor local authority, poor results for people premium, in a school that's got that 10-15% attachment, low. Everything's against us. Why are we, and when we looked at our stats, we were down there, we weren't doing it. So it was massively motivating to think, actually, we can make a difference.
And obviously we won an award last year from DFA.
Oh, thank you, Ben. I forgot to mention that. We've got a letter. We've got a letter from David Lloyd congratulating us on our people premium results. We narrowly missed out on people premium results.
Do we know who, in our group, in our 13-point group that we've got of our cohort as people premium, do we know which schools within our group are performing really well? got the opportunity to go and look over and see what interventions that, you know, that, I mean, I know we're doing very well, but what we're on is doing excellent this year. You've got the idea of the low health fit that year.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you were in the EEM session, there's a family who's
talking. Does that help identify?
So I reckon we need to get on that.
And then cross match it against, as you say, you know the boroughs that are doing well and the areas that are doing well. And maybe we can cross match and find other schools in our situation that are doing exceptionally well. And, yeah,
it's about collaborating ideas, isn't it? It's about looking at a problem and going, right, we've tried the taxes, tried the laptop, and tried the tablets. None of that is working. What else can we do? Because I think that's the problem with schools. You know, you kind of have your menu, if you like. But every now and again, you do need to do some chef specials for kids because you need to go, right, this is not going to work for you. So, right, let's do that and let's do this and let's see what else is ready.
Yeah, agreed. Anyway, if anybody wants any of the documentation I talked about, it's all over there on the site. But thank you very much.